So again, hello everybody. We have had now problems here. This is the third start, so hopefully at least someone is there not giving up for us. So we have about 9 minutes to go to noon when we have the noon reflection. So we are making little bit changes. We do that way that we start the meditation, then we have the noon reflection, and then we continue for a while. So we had this ceremony for calling different groups. So let us again align ourselves to this network, global network of groups. Pirittäydymme nyt kansainväliseen ryhmien verkostoon. And realize that you are integral part of it. Ja näe, että olet tärkeä osa tuota verkostoa. We align with our triangles. And these triangles have very strong role to protect. Ja näiden kolmioiden yksi vahvoista tekijöistä on varjella. So we will start by listening the text, what DK says about the duty of the disciple.
Okay, friends, this is Michael, and I've unfortunately had a bout of laryngitis here. I'll do my best. When everybody first comes into the Arcane School, you won't be able to see this, but if you want to go to Discipleship in the New Age, Volume 1, and you go to page 561, you will be able to see it. I'm going to read it because it powerfully displays the duty of every aspirant to discipleship and even of every disciple. I solemnly pledge to play my part with stern resolve, with earnest aspiration. I look above, I help below. I dream not, nor I rest. I toil, I serve, I reap, I pray. I mount the cross, I tread the way. I tread upon the work I do. I mount upon my slain self. I forego peace. I forfeit rest. And in the stress of pain, I lose myself and find myself, myself, capital S, and enter into peace. He gave this to a disciple who really, I think, needed it quite strongly. Let's see if I can't locate that right now. But it's worth repeating every day. There is a certain straightness, an undeviating earnestness, and the fire of desire is directed upward, earnest aspiration. And although one does always look above, one must help below, so there is the dual life of the disciple. One is not to be lost in astral dreams, which cannot really be realized, so it says, I dream not. And relatively to many people, the stage, nor I rest, is applicable. Because to forfeit rest is part of it. And I'm sure there are many moments in the middle of the night when we're doing these broadcasts, or you're waking up to the broadcasts and webinars, when you wonder why you may be awake, but the opportunity is there, and we have to be awake when we can, even at inconvenient hours. The work, I toil, and I serve without thinking about my little egoistic self. I toil, I serve, I reap the karma that comes to me without great complaint, realizing it's all part of the process. And I do pray, meaning that not only do I meditate, but I reach upward, orienting the aspiration of the astral body towards worthy goals. I mount the cross. Well, we are changing off of the common cross, mutable cross, onto the fixed cross, the cross of the soul. And that is our goal. It's oftentimes done in the sign Pisces. On that cross, we will encounter difficulty. We will encounter blinding light, fiery pain, bitter woe, and finally, liberation. That's the fixed cross that we mount. And I tread the way. I read the six sentences in the way of discipleship, and I fulfill them. I tread upon the work I do. I don't make a big deal out of what I've done. There's some people always holding up what they do for appreciation. It means I keep going forward, regardless of the excellence of what may have been created. There's always more to create, so I don't stop to ask for any kind of praise or reinforcement. Look what I did, you see. That's all part of the lower ego. And I mount upon my slain self, which is of the personality, because it is the little self of personality which is slain, and not the soul itself. And I will continue with this after we have our noon recollection. Is that okay? Yes. We'll do it that way.
I know, O Lord of life and love, about the need. Touch my heart anew with love, that I too may love and give. and few things by decay. One's mental assistance should be always available, but it should not be given when one's mind is bewildered by the fogs of questioning and doubt, or when there is a spirit of criticism. One's spiritual responsibility is, curiously enough, usually the last to be recognized. An action taken on that recognition is equally slow. Yet in the last analysis, it is by far the most important, for one's spiritual influence can be lasting and can carry with it releasing power to those we love, whereas the other responsibilities, being those of personality relationships, always carry with them clamor and that which is not of the kingdom of the Spirit. Let us reflect that. Can you really define that you know what is your spiritual responsibility? DK talks about Buddha. The Buddha has a special function at this time as an interplanetary mediator. And in this capacity, at the coming May festivals, he will attempt to bring certain spiritual beings into touch with our Earth hierarchy. They have expressed themselves as willing to aid in the present crisis. That aid, if the effort proves successful, will come in the form of a much increased spiritual inflow of energy of a kind more potent and of a quality somewhat different to any at this time pouring into and through our planetary life. Those aspirants and disciples who can train themselves to the realization of an increased spiritual responsibility and can preserve an inner quietness and a focused esoteric attentiveness can be swept into this tide of spiritual force and can then and thus serve humanity's need. As transmitters, they meet that need. As interpreters, they increase the capacity of the human being to respond and to understand. I read this again. Those aspirants and disciples who can train themselves to the realization of an increased spiritual responsibility. Can we realize our increased spiritual responsibility? And can preserve an inner quietness? Do we have that? And a focused esoteric attentiveness? Can we find that? that we are focused and esoterically attentive. Are we attentive now when these energies are pouring? Do we participate this movement directed by hierarchy? So when we can preserve a focused esoteric attentiveness, can be swept into this tide of spiritual force, and can then and thus serve humanity's needs. As transmitters, they meet that need. Can we transmit? As interpreters, they can increase the capacity of the human being to respond and to understand. When we look at the evolution, what is happening in Pisces, first it is responsiveness to environment. Then it moves to the states that one becomes sensitive to the soul. And last stage is, very interestingly, spiritual responsibility. So we can have Christ as our prototype again, who is carrying his spiritual responsibility. And as you remember, in Gethsemane, he was realizing, you remember that we have been talking, he is there in despair. But then, in that crushing and weighing despair, he's finding, he's giving us up, and he says, not my will, but thine will be done. And there he takes his full spiritual responsibility. Of course, we are not even pretending that we would be so high. But in small scale, we can think about our spiritual responsibility. Do we accept it the way that Christ did? Because he is our great prototype and leader, an example how to be. It is essential that there should be a presentation of the things in terms of the spiritual welfare of humanity and a truer interpretation of the meaning of the word spiritual. The time is long past when a line of demarcation can be drawn between the religious world and the political or the economic. The reason for the corrupt politics and the greedy ambitions planning of the many of the world's leading men can be found in the fact that spiritually minded men and women have not assumed as their spiritual duty and responsibility the leadership of the people. Can we reflect again? The reason for the corrupt politics and the greedy ambition planning of so many of the world's leading men can be found in the fact that spiritually minded men and women have not assumed as their spiritual duty and responsibility the leadership of the people. This is a deep thing to ponder on. They have left the power in the wrong hands and permitted the selfish and the undesirable to lead. It's a very unpleasant job. Very unpleasant. It's easier to be there in the ranks of people and know everything how things should be than to become the leader and take that responsibility upon oneself. Let us reflect this for a while. Is there something that you know that you should take leadership but you have not done it? An intelligent and cooperative public opinion must be developed in every land, and the doing of this constitutes a major spiritual duty. So again, an intelligent and cooperative public opinion must be developed in every land, and the doing of this constitutes a major spiritual duty. This will take much time, but if the men of goodwill and if the spiritual people of the world will become genuinely active, it can be done in 25 years. The last thing what I'm going to read is related to money, which is one of the key things for us to really solve. It belongs to the physical heads of the Hydra, so it is the thing what is the first things to be solved in our lives. This whole question of money is one of the greatest difficulty at this time and also one of the utmost simplicity. The difficulty is due to the wrong thought which for generations has been brought to bear upon the problem, leading to wrong attitudes even among the most devoted disciples. The attitude of humanity to money has been colored by greed, by grasping for the lower self, by jealousy, by material desire, and by the heartbreaking need for it, which, in its turn, is the result of the wrong attitudes. These wrong attitudes lead to the disastrous economic conditions which we find all around us. They are effects of causes which are initiated by man himself in the regeneration of money and in the charging of man's attitude to it. will eventually come world release. If this cannot take place, then some dire condition will arise. Money as we know it will vanish off the earth, and the situation will have to be met in some other way. Let us hope that this will not be needed, but that it will be possible to change the thought of humanity where money is concerned, so that it will be regarded as a great spiritual asset, as a definite spiritual responsibility, and as a means to real world work. So again, where money is concerned, so that it will be regarded as a great spiritual asset, as a definite spiritual responsibility, and as a means to real world work. The custodians of money will then shoulder their responsibility without fear and with due understanding. At present, they hold on to it through fear of the future and distrust of each other. Is it so true how the world is nowadays? Still, the key to the right expenditure of money and to its correct use can be summed up in the following. Okay, we are not going to that. We will finish this idea of money here. So you can reflect for a while your attitude towards money. When we think about Master DK's meditation about money, he is ending this meditation that we are all to reflect the love the best we can and to express it to every single human being that we meet. So ponder upon this. Ponder upon that money is a spiritual responsibility. And again, how do you find or know your spiritual responsibility or your spiritual responsibilities? We end this kind of imaginative situation. See before you a door. and you go through that door, and there is a little meeting room. Imaginatively discuss with your inner leader, your master, about your spiritual responsibility. You are given a paper into which is written these responsibilities or responsibility, your next step. And it can be also in the form of a symbol. Look at that now. So take this seriously in that sense that when this week is over, be determined that you will know what is your next step. And you will know for sure what is your spiritual responsibility. And we will end our meditation by sounding our bells. And then we wish you Merry Christmas to everybody. We will continue at 12:30 p.m. GMT with a webinar. Toivotamme teidät tervetulleeksi kello 14:30 jatkamaan kanssamme. Just a little second, I will check that it is correct this time. So I will just, yes, 12:30 p.m. GMT. We will have a webinar. We will discuss and it is written telepathic communication between servers. It might be one of the subjects, but we will have now many subjects that we will take them into our considerations. So, goodbye for a while from here, from Finland, and as said, we wish you a Merry Christmas.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.